Okay, good afternoon. I'm Barbara Wysocki, president of the League of Women Voters of Champaign County. This is the third in our series of county community conversations examining the impact in our county of the state of Illinois' failure to produce an annual budget. Today we turn our attention to the impact of state decisions regarding our homeless population and the agencies that serve them. At this point in time, it being November the 16th, not only is Illinois without a budget for 18 months, but a stopgap measure approved in the summer is going to expire next month. To date, no negotiations regarding the next 6 months are in process, and certainly no attention has yet been given to the next budget year, which begins next July. In addition, winter is soon to be with us, and winter usually adds urgency on already stressed agencies to provide both food and shelter to those in our community without resources. I want to introduce our panelists for today. We have Esther Patt, who for many years has been associated with the Champaign-Urbana Tenants Union and now does that work on a volunteer basis. Beverly Baker, who is the United Way's Director of Community Impact. She also represents United Way on the Council of Service Providers to the Homeless and on the Continuum of Care. Those are two separate groups, right? And thirdly, Kelly Mirkowski, who is associated with the City of Urbana, and she is Director of the Grants Management Division. Following their comments and the presentation here, I'm going to ask you as the audience to ask the questions that you have for one or more of our guests. So think about what we still need to know as you listen to their presentations. So let's begin by just giving our audiences, both here and in television land, sort of your perspective, your overview of what is the status of the homeless situation in our community and the various agencies that have tried or are trying to address their needs.
You can start?
Sure.
Okay, well, thank you. Actually, my perspective on homelessness has always been on the causal part, because I see at the Champaign-Urbana Tenant Union, mostly we do get contacted by homeless people looking for housing, but mostly we have contact with people before they become homeless. Every month, between two and actually it's getting closer to three dozen households contact us about being evicted. They are being evicted for non-payment of rent. They are not paying rent because the portion of their income that has to go to rent is too high for any reasonable situation, and a lot of times I'm just amazed when I get the specifics how they managed to avoid being evicted up until now. And the sad thing is once they get evicted, the sad thing is they get evicted, so they lose their housing, and then even if they can get more money and could afford another place, virtually no landlord will rent to them because they have an eviction on their credit record. Among the homeless people in Champaign-Urbana are a large number of people who simply cannot afford rent, and that's why they remain homeless. But also, people, it depends, you know, how you define homeless, but the people who live in motels, a lot of them are people who could afford rent, but a landlord won't rent to them because of their bad credit record. Or there are some people who could afford rent, but what they need is a damage deposit. And they just make enough money each month to cover their expenses, and every time they're gonna have to move, including their first time, they're gonna need to come up with basically like an extra month's rent to pay for a damage deposit, and they just don't have that money. Homelessness is all about money. And that's one thing that's very frustrating to me. Whenever people try to figure out what psychosocial, blah, blah, it's the money. It's really just about money. The people just like you and me, except they have a whole lot less money, so they can't afford their housing. I prepared two handouts. This was more than a week ago before the election, when the punchline was going to be the state budget. The state's a mess. What we have to do is push more to the federal government for funding. It's not going to work anymore. Though I will mention, just for the sake of, there's always a give up. Barb mentioned that the state has not passed a budget. The HUD budget, the Department of Housing and Urban Development budget for fiscal year 17, which the federal government's fiscal year starts October 1st, that's already at play. That budget has not yet been passed. There's going to be a vote in the U.S. House of Representatives tomorrow. I received an alert from the National Low Income Housing Coalition asking us to please contact our members of the House of Representatives and ask them to vote for a permanent HUD budget and not just approve another continuing resolution tomorrow. Not to be cynical, but realistically, they're going to pass another continuing resolution and wait until President Trump takes office, and the plan is to cut the HUD budget every single year. So there's not a whole lot of hope. But I will point out to you that one of the handouts I gave you had some statistics just nationally on who is homeless. And the one thing I always like to point out to people are families with children, because a whole lot of people think homeless are the ragtaggedy men they see on the street. And those ragtaggedy men are a tiny percent of the homeless. Champaign-Urbana Schools reported 340-some children homeless last year in just Champaign-Urbana Schools. Add the homeless children in the county, add all children under the age of 5 who aren't counted at the school count, add the children whose parents are concealing the homelessness from the schools for fear of losing their children. And I mean, we have at least 500, probably more than 500 homeless children and their families in Champaign County. Last thing I just want to point out before I pass this along on this other sheet, understanding affordable housing. Here's really what the whole problem is, and I'm not going to redo this whole handout, but if you are a person with a disability and your sole source of income is supplemental security income, that is about $720 a month. That's $8,600 a year is your annual income. If you use the HUD standard that your housing cost should not be more than 30% of your rent, and actually even forget that now, just 30% of your income, forget housing costs, forget utilities, just base rent should not be more than 30% of your income. For a person on SSI, that gives them $216 a month. I don't know how familiar you all are with the local housing market, but the cheapest one-bedroom apartments I find are occasionally $450 to $480, but pretty much it's $500 a month plus utilities for a small, cheap, probably substandard place, and this is half that, less than half that. For a single person working full-time year-round minimum wage, $17,160 is their income, $429 per month is what they can afford for rent. Again, for one person, that's bad. If you're a single wage earner with two children, a two-bedroom apartment at the affordable housing for low-income people that federal tax money is going to, you have to pay at least $650 a month. And that's really what I think the punchline in terms of understanding all. What I see is the problem with affordable housing programs, how they're not addressing the needs of the homeless, is they don't dip down low enough. Except for what Housing Authority does with housing subsidies, everything else in town that gets called affordable housing, if you look at that chart, at the top, near the top of the page, it says income summary limits. Very low income, what HUD defines as very low income, is 50% of area median income. So anyone can get federal, not anyone, but when they get federal tax credits to develop housing, a two-bedroom apartment has to be affordable to someone whose income is between $28,000 and $31,000 a year. And that's where the rents are set. And so when you think of how much money is $28,000 versus the minimum wage earners getting $17,000, you have to make $26,000 a year to afford low-cost housing for affordable people. And one of the things, if we didn't just lose the state and Congress, I would suggest is we need to push for more funding for housing for households with income below 30% of area median. But in the short run, given that the services for the homeless people are disappearing mostly, what we really need, I think, more than anything, is more money for rent assistance to help prevent families who currently have housing from losing it. Too many people get evicted for an amount less than $1,000. Sometimes it's even $250. They're $215 behind on the rent, they get evicted. And if only they could get that $215 from someone, that would at least keep them going a little longer. And I hope when we get into more discussion, we talk about how we can raise that money to do that. Thank you.
Beverly?
Me next. I'm going to be a little bit more, I didn't prepare handouts, I'm going to be a little bit brief so we can get on to Kelly and the questions, but our overview from United Way is that Really there, as Esther said, there are changes taking place at HUD. The funding that is coming for homelessness, it looks different than it did many years ago. Really over the past 5 to 10 years, it has changed significantly. So there are still dollars coming, but they look different. And that as a local community, we're being asked to absorb that burden and to look strategically at what's available in our community and how to fund it from a local level, because the state and federal dollars just aren't there anymore. And so that's something that we're trying to do through the Council of Service Providers and through the Continuum of Care, is to stay abreast of those changes at HUD and how that's going to impact us here as a community. It's a big ship to turn. It's not a shift that can happen overnight, and it's taken us a long time, I think, to grasp exactly what those changes are going to look like and the results and the impact that they're going to have here. But I think that we're positioning ourselves, and I think the service providers that have traditionally served the homeless are positioning themselves to adjust those changes and adjust their programs and services. But there is going to be a greater reliance on our local community to provide those local funds. We're never going to be able to make up the difference of what HUD was once funding, but we're going to have to look at the core basic services that we want to be sure are available and how we can strategically ensure that they are in fact there.
Just for the information of our audiences, could you at least broadly define these two consortiums and how their mission differs?
Sure. And Kelly, jump in and help me.
Yeah,
you're a part of those
I'm
as well.
Also, okay. I represent the City of Urbana on the Council of Service Providers for the Homeless, and I'm also on the Executive Committee for the Continuum of Care. So I'll let Bev jump in first.
The Council of Service Providers to the Homeless is really it's more grassroots. There is a structure around it, and we have a chair, and you know, we take minutes and things like that, but there's not, it's not its own standalone 501c3 nonprofit organization. It's probably very much a grassroots.
More faith-based.
It has more faith-based, more community-based, just concerned individuals are a part of that group as well. Then the Continuum does have a different structure, and it's a HUD-mandated structure.
Yes, it's required by HUD
For
communities that receive homeless funds through HUD, and it was set up probably 20 years ago, required, or maybe 10, 15?
Mm-hmm. It was 20 years.
Is it 20?
Yeah.
And so a lot of some of the same groups attend both, but it's really around the HUD funding and the agencies that receive the homeless funds.
And is it some type of monitor? I mean, is there some monitoring, mm-hmm, reporting that's required to HUD?
Yes,
Right.
HUD has a requirement that they monitor anyone who receives funds from them, but they have now placed more, mm-hmm, responsibility on the Continuum of Care to do monitoring of agencies that have received the funding from HUD. Yeah. And they also have the renewal applications that they do, because there's a lot of information that is required. They also do a point in time survey, which actually I have the results of that. This is required by HUD every January. They pick one night where they go out to places that where individuals may be found, and it's the places they talk to the police and others where people may congregate, and they list where they searched, where they found people, and what the temperature was over a 10-year period. I mean, so there's a lot of information that you have to, you know, and then they use that to help with trying to get more funding. Of course, you know, HUD funding, federal funding, you know,
is not there.
I mean, our division with the city, we administer the grant funds from the federal government, also some state funds that come from HUD to the state, and then we administer those as well. So our largest is like our community development block grant and our home partnership grant, and we have been cut. Since I've been with the city about 11 years, we've been cut quite a bit with our federal funds. So we're, of course, you know, trying to look at other ways that we can use the funds to assist. But anyway, so
That's the difference between the two bodies. So they work very closely together. In fact, their meetings piggyback so that people who do want to attend both can attend both, but then there are some that just attend one or the other. So they do work collaboratively together, but they are separate and their roles are very separate.
Okay.
And Council of Service Providers to the Homeless does not have to answer to anyone else.
Correct.
It's just a community group.
Right. It's just grassroots community members.
Okay.
Okay.
Kelly, do you want to add more? You were referring to a study, the results of a study?
Yes. So the Continuum Care did their point in time survey was on January 28th of this year. So according to what was found, there were 188 persons, including 30 children, in 146 households that were considered homeless in this county. 170 were sheltered, while 18 were unsheltered. And of those surveyed, at least five were classified as chronically homeless, meaning that they've been homeless for over 1 year or four or more times in 3 years and have a disabling condition. At least 23 persons were identified as having severe mental illness, 28 with substance abuse disorder, two with HIV/AIDS, and 31 persons were identified as victims of domestic violence, and 18 men identified as veterans. So then there were 25 households that comprised of youth, totaling 30 persons who were homeless, considered homeless youth. And it's completed annually so that the local homeless providers can measure the effectiveness of existing services that we have and identify possible additional approaches that are needed to address the needs for shelter and housing options. Just a note, on January 2015, the previous year, we identified 163 homeless persons in this county, and so we've seen an increase in 25 this year. And then they showed by percentage, so that's what we found in actually on our, and we're already starting to prepare for the one this coming January.
So since you're of the three, you're the one connected with a municipal government.
What's your money?
What are you seeing from that governmental perch that Esther or Beverly aren't seeing? Or is it a pretty consistent vision?
I say it's pretty consistent. Thinking about one thing that the city of Urbana has done, and they have done it for, it's been like 20 years this year, is our consolidated social service funding. So I think last year or this past year, it was like $250,000, and we have agencies, homeless providers, disability, and all different that apply for funding and have consistently applied for funding. And we have seen an increase in some applications because of cuts in state budget and such. So our next application process will be in March, and so we'll see how that goes as well. That is a commitment that the council and the mayor have said, that helping Urbana residents by helping social service agencies that provide those services. So in light of cuts everywhere else, the city has maintained to keep that service funding. So
are your funds focused exclusively on Urbana residents who find themselves homeless? Or
no, it's a variety of it's for agencies that provide services to Urbana residents.
Okay.
And some of, like Courage Connection and others that do provide homeless individuals and families do receive funding, but it's not just exclusively that. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different social service agencies that receive funding.
Okay.
May I ask a question?
Certainly.
The homeless that one night count is way low, and it's even lower than it's been the last few years. Do you know where all they go? I mean, I know they're out trying to find people out on the street, and that includes the inventory of who's actually sheltered also, right? At Courage Connection and at
Yes,
Time
they
Center.
Do. Yeah, they check with the shelters as well, but they also searched campus quad bar area, Springfield and Neal near railroad tracks, downtown Champaign around the Illinois Terminal.
Outside areas, basically.
Canteen Run, which is services provided by Salvation Army. Around the library in Champaign, Crystal Lake Fairgrounds in Scott Park in Urbana, South Philo Road, Walmart, downtown Urbana, Lincoln Square, Savoy Walmart. And they also went to Rantoul this year as well. So the Community Services Center of Northern Champaign County also.
Those counts.
So that's where they searched.
It's good. I'm not that they do, but that's a gross. I just, for anyone who's watching on TV and hears, there's only 185 homeless people in Champaign County. First of all, it's one night, and that was pointed out. That's a one night count, and homelessness is not a static condition like being female or Greek American. You know. People who are homeless right now were not homeless 6 months ago and might very well not be homeless 6 months from now, but might very well be homeless a year from now. And that's the way it goes. But I think children are really grossly undercounted because they are not out. I mean, how often have you ever seen a homeless child and realized you saw it, a homeless child? You know, it's just, they're a lot harder to count, and parents do conceal it more. So that's just so people understand, again, the schools found in the course of a year, just Champaign and Urbana schools alone, just homeless children aged approximately 5 to 19, last year, there were 242 in Urbana, so it was between 90 and 100. So 340 homeless children just there. And most of them are not sleeping, you know, on campus or on the street, but they are, in fact, without homes.
And the school's definition of homeless is different than the HUD definition of homeless. And that needs to be recognized, too. The HUD definition of homelessness is, you know, on the streets, living in places not meant for human habitation. Mm-hmm. The schools go by the McKinney-Vento definition, which is a little bit different. It, of course, takes those elements into consideration as well, but it's also those that may be precariously housed. They may be couch surfing, they may be living or staying with family member or friends, you know, bouncing from one place to the next. So the school district definition is different than the HUD definition. It's a little bit broader.
Yeah. If you're living in a mini warehouse, you're not going to get counted because you're not going to let anyone know you're living in the mini warehouse. And I'm not saying there are a lot of children living in mini warehouses, but that's the type, some of the stuff that's going on. But couch surfing is probably the biggest. Mm-hmm. And also this is what kills me, the HUD doesn't count them as homeless. If one child is couch surfing one place and another child couch surfing another place and mom is the third place, in my mind, that family is homeless. The children aren't sleeping on the street, but the fact that the child slept at seven different places in the last 10 weeks and none of them the same place mama was sleeping, if that's not homeless, I mean, I'm glad they're not on the street, but in terms of what we should be doing, we should be seeing them as homeless too, and I'm glad the schools do.
We heard at this meeting two months ago about the invisible nature of homelessness. And it's, I think what you're sharing with us is that somehow this group of people finds ways to meet their needs, such as they are, even if it means, as you said, sleeping in seven different couches over the period of a week and a half. But also, when they are on the street and when they are moving around to find resources or to find food sources, they're still not obvious to us. How does that affect the ability to offer services to help them to stabilize the situation, their situation?
You know, if they're harder to see, they're harder to help, they're harder to identify. If they don't come for help, then we often don't know that they're there. And that's most of these services are a here's our building, here's our services, here's what we do, here's what you have to qualify, you know, to be able to receive services, and then the individual has to come to them. Those that are chronically homeless know those services and either choose to engage or choose not to engage because they've been there, done that, don't want to jump through the hoops or meet the regulations. But then there are others who don't feel like they're there yet, or because of embarrassment, don't make that step to reach out for help. And that's where working so closely with our schools and their social workers and youth programs are important for catching those families who may not, you know, they be trying to camouflage or hide the fact that their family is precariously housed. So it's important to try and reach them before the situation spirals and escalates mm-hmm. even further. And that's where outreach is necessary.
And does the collaboration that goes on between community organizations help in that process of identifying?
I would say absolutely. And I think our schools, in particular Champaign and Urbana school districts, because they see, you know, they're the population hub, the population center for our county, see the most number of homeless students in their buildings. I think they have really done a great job of looking at this differently than they did a few years ago. They're really looking at how they respond to these students, how they identify, what types of things they can do to help them. So I think that the schools are really coming on board as partners in ways that they never have before. And in fact, they have representatives that now attend the meetings that Kelly and I have talked about, which is great for them to better understand the types of programs and services that are out there. But at the end of the day, there's not enough of those types of programs and services to help the individuals that need them. And that's where you can identify them, and you can recognize, they can recognize that they need help. They can be identified that, yep, they in fact are homeless, but there's not necessarily the capacity of programs and services and funds to help improve their situation. So we can do all the identification we want if the help isn't available.
There's really not help. I mean, there's not help for a large number, and the number who are not going to get help now is going to grow. And that's really the biggest challenge right now, is that we really weren't even really getting close to meeting the need entirely, and now we're going to have even fewer resources to do that. I mean, I don't know where. I was mentioning earlier that it's been years since I've been able to make a successful referral of a homeless woman with children to Courage Connection, or before that, Center for Women in Transition, because they were already filled. And whenever I would suggest to a client, but have you called, they say, yes, I called, they have no space. So there's always, in fact, at one time, I remember Center for Women in Transition was turning away, in the course of a year, the number of families they had to turn away because they had no space was greater than the number that they were serving. Now, all of those families who are not involved in domestic violence will not be able to be sheltered at Courage Connection anymore because of the funding cut. And I don't know, do you know the numbers at Times Center, how much it dropped?
It dropped from 75 to 20.
Yeah, okay, right. And that's, and again, there are a lot of people who are homeless who weren't staying at Times Center because they either got banned or they didn't want to stay there or whatever. And so, yeah, we're talking, people should understand, this isn't a handful of people we have to address. There are hundreds of people every year who need to be sheltered and who need financial assistance if we're going to get them out of homelessness, and at least hundreds more, multiple hundreds more, who could use financial assistance to prevent becoming homeless in the first place. So it's a really big problem that's just gotten bigger. So what do we do?
Yeah, that was sort of where I'm moving. Where do you see the biggest holes in the community's safety net, such as it is, and how might the community address these gaps that still exist?
From my vantage point at United Way and the information, the data that we get from 211 is that really rent and utility assistance is huge, that there just isn't enough capacity there for the individuals needing that kind of help. Along with that is the financial education, because if these individuals keep coming back, you know, you can get help periodically more than once. But if they continue to come back time and time and time again, that just continues to deplete the pool for others that need the help. So not only do they need, you know, one-time help or short-term help, but then they've got to look at that long-term picture. What do you need to do to improve your situation? You know, making changes in your living environment, making changes in your spending habits. What can you do to improve your education or your job outlook? For those types of factors that can be changed. For some, it just is what it is, and they're not able to make changes because of maybe a disability, a mental health or a substance abuse issue, things like that. But so it's that rental assistance, utility assistance, and then the financial education that goes along with it. And then there's the affordable housing piece. We are in a community that thrives because we have a wonderful university, but our rental rates a lot of times are driven by the university market. And, you know, multiple students can combine together and live in a nice unit. And so that's a challenge then for a family living on, you know, maybe two minimum wage income workers whose hours are going to fluctuate depending on the retail season or the service delivery season. So it's difficult to find that affordable housing. So from my viewpoint, those are some of the largest holes. And then the emergency shelter too. There's not the federal funds available for emergency. It's moving towards rapid rehousing and supportive housing, which are great, but there are individuals who are chronically homeless and need some sort of intervention, some sort of service, because before they move into that, or they may never be equipped to move into that type of living environment. So there always needs to be a basic level of emergency service as well. And figuring out what that's going to look like is a challenge because there aren't the funds for it.
Yeah, when 211 service first was announced here, and I think it was United Way who introduced it, what was it, 3 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What I went to presentation, and the first thing they said was, nationwide, the most common request, 211 is people don't know where to go, so they call for I have this need, what agency helps. Nationwide, the number one call is for rent assistance. And as soon as 211 service started, tenant union, which does not have cash to provide rent assistance, started getting a whole bunch of calls asking us for rent assistance, and we still do, not as nearly as much, but that is what, initially I think they were referring us them to us because they didn't know where else to send them, but there's very little in the way of rent assistance here. If you call, I don't have the number off the top of my head, but Regional Planning Commission gets some money sometimes to provide rent assistance to stop eviction. And you call and there's a recorded message that usually tells you we're out of funds. And if they do have some money, then they say, call back Monday morning between 8 a.m. and noon, and it's first come, first serve. And of course they can't begin to serve all the people who need it. If you're familiar with the Low Income Housing Energy Assistance Program, that will run out of funds too before everyone gets help. But when you look at how well that's working compared to that, the rent assistance is has much less funding and far fewer people can be served by it. And that, I think, I'm glad to hear you say this because, you know, from my point of view, attending, yeah, I'm just like watching them fall off the cliff and not being able to stop it in most cases. And what people really need is they need rent assistance. If you lose your job, and you get another job 3 weeks later, just losing 3 weeks of pay is enough to fall behind on the rent and get evicted if you don't have savings. And very low-income people just don't have savings. So I think that really, if there were one thing I would like to see, is a lot more money for rent assistance. But given what's just happened in terms of losing the state funding for the shelters, there's also just the reality of all the people who do live on the street. And, you know, and even the couch surfers, I mean, there's a mix of couch surfing. You know, there are people who sometimes have a place and sometimes don't. And in between, you know, where do they go? And I'm not sure, they don't always say, but, you know, they go around where they can. And that's, yeah. I just would say one also thing about a lot of people in this town, I mean, since it's such so popular in Champaign-Urbana, they blame students for everything. And I know you weren't saying that, but a lot of people always jump to, is it the students that... Champaign-Urbana is not the only community in central Illinois, in the state of Illinois, or in the United States that has an affordable housing crisis. The big problem, we have more high rents here because we have more people who can pay, you know, and that was that point about the unrelated adults living together. But as far as the population at risk of being homeless, this could be Decatur, this could be Quincy. It's the same problem, is that market rent is set for people whose income is higher than the poverty level. And when you've got a 22% poverty rate in your county, you're obviously going to have homeless people because they can't afford any of the housing out there.
Would an increase in the state minimum wage help the situation?
Actually, initially it probably would, because I'll give you a statistic. To afford a an apartment in tax credit, low-cost housing for poor people, right now I mentioned you have to make the rent $650 say for a cheap two-bedroom. So yeah, you have to make at least $26,000 a year. Used to be that the statistic was that a minimum wage worker had to work 71 hours a week in order to afford one of those apartments in the complexes where the owner is getting federal tax credits for renting to low-income people, because they define low income as so high. And when minimum wage first went up, now it's down to 61 hours a week you have to work to be able to afford it, which is still ridiculous, especially if you have children. And so it does matter. But I do think that if minimum wage went up, I mean, what we've seen is rents will go up when minimum wage goes up. So that's the problem. But initially, another minimum wage increase would certainly help. You know, it just won't have a long-term effect, because I think the rents will rise. Rent, you know, whenever people talk about what causes rent, and I'm having to deal with this for a lot of other reasons, rents are whatever the market will bear. You know, that's really what it comes down to. And that's why the best place to find affordable housing, with the cheapest housing around here, is all the substandard housing. And everything that communities do, and I'm not saying it's wrong, but everything we do to stop blight and to redevelop, you know, the redevelopment, the Bristol Place, it all eliminates affordable housing. Now, people who are poor shouldn't have to live in substandard housing, so we don't want the crop of the market of affordable housing to be all the substandard stuff. But mainly what fuels substandard housing existing is the fact that so many people can't afford market rent. So it's the two tied together.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to say I agree with these, you know, the things that I've said about the gaps, and I want to say some ways that we have tried to address those.
Please do.
One example would be with our federal dollars, our home program. We have the Urbana Home Consortium, which is made up of the City of Urbana, City of Champaign, and Champaign County. And so we, as a consortium, receive money from HUD, and then we disperse it. And one program that we have had has been the tenant-based rental assistance program, and we have put quite a few dollars. It's like a voucher, and it is for low-income people with, you know, lower medium family incomes, and the Regional Planning Commission is the one who administers that. We also have given funds to Courage Connection, to Rosecrans, others to run a TBRA program as well. And we're also looking at maybe expanding that, you know, seeing what other uses that the home funds can be used for to address any other needs. So that is something that we are looking at as well. But we have put, you know, quite a bit of funds in the community over the years in that program to help. I mean, it just, of course, doesn't help everybody, but we help as many as we can with that. And another one, you know, Habitat for Humanity also receives home funds as well because of building affordable housing. And they have other grant funds as well, and they've been able to assist with affordable housing for a lot of families in the community as well.
Do you know the approximate income range of who they serve? Do they get down to $25,000 a year, you think?
I'm not sure what. At least 50%.
Yeah, 50%. Like that's $650 a month.
Maybe,
yeah, right,
you know,
$26,000.
At least, yes, it could be lower. Mm-hmm.
In a program like Habitat for Humanity, for example. People who are interested in a home that's been rehabbed have to go through an application process.
They do.
To be considered.
They do, and then they also actually have like a program to help people, families, so that, you know, if they're accepted, then they can learn how to maintain their house, and they, you know, so they won't end up losing it down the road.
Okay.
And I think that I think in all that they've had, they're at like 90 houses that they have either rehabbed or new construction. And the families have to be part of, you know, with sweat equity and helping build.
But a big piece of that program is the financial education that goes along with it, too. Learning about general home maintenance and you know, how to prepare for, we need new gutters, or that roof needs a repair, or got a piece of siding coming loose, or there's a leak under my sink, and addressing those things sooner rather than later, helping them, because people who have been renters and maybe never been involved in home ownership, that's a whole new set of skills and a whole new thought process for them. So the education piece is important. So there's the general maintenance piece and preparing for that. And how do you prepare for that? You have savings. So there's that financial education piece. This is what your income needs to look like. How do you look at your utility bills?
Yeah.
How do you save for a rainy day so you can make these repairs when they're needed? So,
and that's also why, you know, I love Habitat for Humanity, but if we're talking about homelessness, we shouldn't be talking about Habitat for Humanity, because there's a huge income gap between the population who can't afford a place to live and the minimum income you need to afford home ownership, even with the help. Habitat Humanity and a lot of federally funded programs or things, the partnerships, federal, private, public, are about, and this is why the HUD definitions seem so goofy from the renter point of view of what they call low income. They're about helping people, not people who can't afford a place to live, but people who can't afford home ownership to be able to afford home ownership. And there are people who, and even in this community with the wacky dynamic, that there are people who are paying more money for rent than they would pay for their mortgage and insurance, you know, and property tax at a Habitat house, and that's where it's good. But the big, I mean, I sort of said this in the beginning, but I'll say it again, the vast majority of federal dollars for affordable housing go for some programs that serve people with incomes way over the poverty level. There's very little money for people whose incomes are under the poverty level. And in fact, you know, that tenant-based rent assistance, I think it was about 10 years ago, actually it was probably the first year you were here, you might remember this, a bunch of people came to Urbana City Council chambers when the comprehensive plan or the consolidated plan was being discussed and said, more money for tenant-based rent assistance, and that we needed. We talked about homelessness and everything. And then the city did respond, that the Community Development Department and the Commission came out with a bigger amount for tenant-based rent assistance in that money. But most of the home money that what is it now, 800,000 the three communities get, you think? Or has it dropped even more, 500 now?
We're down to like 600,000.
Yeah. At one time it was a million when it first started back in 94.
So, yeah.
But that 600,000, the majority of that 600,000 is not going to tenant-based rent assistance or anything that helps what I consider really poor people. It's not, they're good programs, but they're for things like, a lot of the money over the years has gone to development of these tax credit places where the rent is at least $650 a month for a two-bedroom apartment. And money for senior home repair. And these are low-income seniors, but they are people who own their own home. And that's really the problem, is the competing. If we're going to talk about any local resources that already exist and wanting to move more toward addressing the needs of the homeless, it has to come from someplace else. We have to say, okay, we're not going to do that development on Curry Avenue because we want all the money for this. Or no, we're not going to redevelop Bristol Place in Champaign because we want all the money for this. And realistically, that's not going to happen. Frankly, one of the questions that Barb had that sent us before the meetings was about what are our local, you know, what resources do we have locally? Actually, the only growing resource we have, here's the personal challenge. I look around the room, I know who a lot of you are, you know who I am. The increasing incomes of people like us, that's really the biggest resource. The only real resource we have that is not already tapped in this community is people with money giving more. And then, of course, it's how do we decide what it is, but getting together to try to raise the money, I don't know what else we can do about being able to return the capacity of Courage Connection and the capacity of Time Center to what they were a year ago we need money. And I don't see money coming from federal or state, and I don't see it coming from the local unless we take it out of other things. But there is a lot of money in this community. I know it's already going to lots of other things, including my agency and a lot of the United Way agencies, but we need more. And I think that's, I don't know where else we can turn for it. Mm-hmm.
And when I said that the burden's gonna fall on the local community because it's not coming from HUD, this is local community.
Right, you know, not the city governments,
right.
But
right.
Us and y'all.
Yeah. Locally raised. Yeah. Locally raised.
Yeah. We, because of recipients of the tax haters. You know, we are going to end up, they don't want to pay taxes. We're willing to pay, but there's not enough of us.
Yes.
So we're going to end up subsidizing more from our disposable income because the fat cats don't want to let go of a single nickel. They want to pay for somebody who just won't do for themselves. It's pretty disgusting. So, you know, we are in fact going to become Ronner's people because this is this is what's being tried in this state and elsewhere. And I mean, I agree with what you say, Esther, but there's something about it. It's like we've just turned this over to allow government to say this is what is going to happen.
Well, you and I didn't turn it over, but a bunch of other people did.
Yeah, so. It's almost like we're saying, gosh, you know, this is the reality, and, you know, this is what we're going to have to do.
It is the reality.
Well, you can choose where your money goes, or you can have the government choose where your money goes. So, you know, by giving, you can either... I mean, I've lived in other states, and what we've experienced here in Illinois in the past 10 years has been just the number of programs, the number of services. When we look at the taxes, it is incredibly alarming than compared to other states across the Midwest. And I think that this is, I've called it, it's like a forest fire, where it's painful. And we look at it, and gosh, we go through it every council service providers meeting, we go through it from a United Way standpoint when we look at organizations that are asking for funding and we don't have enough to fully grant their request. It's like a forest fire. There are our social services network is being decimated. But at some point, all of this hardship is going to make programs that maybe weren't healthy to begin with, unfortunately, go away. And then we as a community have to figure out what programs and services are absolutely critical and vital. And then we have to figure out how to put that network back together and build it up stronger. So as awful and as decimating as the current situation is with the lack of state budget and so forth, we have to use this period of struggle to really look at what's in our community and what we realistically can support and what we realistically need so that we can ensure that what does survive or what comes back is stronger. And, you know, I do not want to go down a political a political road here. But...
Well, I think this is a good point to engage our audience a little more because I can see hands in the air and I'm sure there's questions and comments coming in from their direction. So let's begin. I always in the back row. Kathy?
I've got a couple of questions. The first one, when the utility assistance was talked about versus the rental assistance, and the comment was made the utility assistance seems to work better. So I'm curious as to the difference in the administration, the funding source. Other question is, when the comment was made about needing financial education for the homeless, how and what do you deliver? When you talk about that, so that it maybe will help them stay out of being homeless. I'm somewhat familiar with what Habitat does, but that really is kind of a different.
Absolutely, there's a very different approach to providing financial education when you're homeless and literally have no funds to manage, to having some funds, being on a very restrictive income, and figuring out how to do it. To being in a situation where you have funds and you have savings and you can prepare for a rainy day. So those are all very different conversations. And I think when we're talking homelessness, it's not so much about financial education, because if you don't have funds to manage, there's not a conversation to have.
Yeah, right.
Well, are you thinking though, do you start like with in the schools, in like at the Boys Girls Club?
Right, it's more that prevention. It's more that prevention conversation. So that
And in answer on the low income housing energy assistance program, I don't know how long it's existed, but I know since the 70s and maybe 60s even. I mean, it's a federal program, low income housing energy assistance program, and it's I moved here in 1973, and we are, and Urban League at the time was already running it. So it's been around for a long time, and I'm not saying it's, well, whoever, you know, Regional Planning Commission is running it, someone will watch this thing. No, Esther, our funding's been cut too. I don't know. I don't know their funding, but just compared to the rent assistance, that is not federal money. That was state. I forget which source of state money it was. Do you know, Kelly, where they got it? Because there were two things. I might have been housing trust fund money, but I don't think so. But it was something state money. It's only been the last few years, and it's just a whole lot less money, and it's not always reliable. And I don't know. I mean, it wasn't before all this with the budget, even before Rauner was governor. It was not reliable. But I don't think it's even been. I think maybe 5 or 6 years has only been. Maybe it's a little longer that they've had that money. So basically, low-income housing energy assistance program is a long-established program. And I don't know if the reason. This could be wrong in my mind. But I know, like, when public housing was first created back in the 40s, one of the stated purposes was to help the construction industry. And that's where support for that came from. Yeah. And likewise, I suspect low-income housing energy assistance program does have something that the support for it, I say that now, you'll see Congress will slash it too, but right now, I think the support for it probably comes from the fact that the money's going to public utility companies. So it's not just a, you know, helping the needy, because as you know, that's not politically popular among a lot of people, helping the needy, even though it's obviously what all of us care about. But I don't know more about details of that, other than it's a well-established program that is funded with federal guidelines, with federal money and under federal guidelines, and it's been going on for years, for decades.
Pat?
What happens to me if I am new to the community, I'm single, I've got a low-paying job, minimum wage job, and I come to you and I ask, what can you do for me?
What do you need? It depends. I mean, if you just ask, what can you do for me, no one's going to be able to help you. You have to tell, what is the need that you have? What can I do for you?
All right, I need a place to live.
Oh, you're shopping for housing. Okay. Actually, well, I guess if you're a single person and you're working full-time minimum wage, so you're making $17,000 a year, you might be able to afford something. And I mean, we would do a tenant unit, tell you about the cheapest places we know about that are not the horrible places you're probably going to end up. I mean, I go through listings. I sit up for an hour on Craigslist, you know, and go through the newspaper, which doesn't have much anymore, and try to find who has something, who has one-bedroom apartments under 500 or studios under 500 a month, other than, I won't name their names out loud because I won't get sued, but the four big companies who stink, who a lot of people rent from because that's all they can find, they can afford. I look for, is there anything other than that? And I could also tell you about the ones who are terrible, but I would give you my disclaimer and tell you why. But that's it. As far as if you can't afford any of that, if the deal is that no, actually, like say if you had 30 hours a week and you're only making $12,000 and you can't afford the rent, then there's absolutely no place. I could tell you that, you know, stay in touch with us, and when the Housing Authority opens its wait list for Housing Choice vouchers, I can tell you about applying for it and getting on the list and waiting until someday a voucher comes up. Although the other thing also is if you are age 55 or older, if we're talking about, you know, actually the people in this room, right now if you needed a place, I wouldn't be able to get you a place tomorrow, but I would let you know that the Housing Authority of Champaign County's wait list for one-bedroom apartments for people age 55 and older is now open and will be open until December 31st, and you can apply online at hacc.net. And if you don't have computer access, you can go to the library, and if the library has banned you, so you can't come to the tenant union, sit at our computer, and we'll do it for you or with you. But that's the extent of what we can do. But if you need the money, we don't have the money. All we can do is tell you where you can go, and most of the time, there's no place you can go for it.
So really, you're a directory service, and in the meantime, what does someone like me do?
In the meantime, if you just came here for a job without a place to live, hopefully you have some friend or relative. Otherwise, I would wonder why you came here without a place to live. And, you know, and just so you know, what Champaign-Urbana Tenant Union primarily does is helps people with landlord-tenant issues. So when you are mad your landlord's not doing repairs and you've decided not to pay them, and you call me and you scream at me about how horrible the landlord is and you use the F word 27 times, etc., and then I try to bring you down to understanding that if you don't pay the rent, you're going to be evicted. That's actually the main thing I do at my job. And then, if you haven't hung up on me yet, then talk to you about what you can do about trying to get the repair problems taken care of. which actually a lot of people will hang in for that. You know. So that's mostly what we do at tenant union. But as far as for housing, yeah, we can tell you about wait lists when they're open. We can tell you about the whatever stuff we can find on the market. But if you do not make enough money to afford rent, you know, we can't do anything for you because, you know, there's just nothing there. And that's the problem.
All right. Yeah. Now I come to you. Mm-hmm. What can you do for me?
Mm-hmm. Well, United Way doesn't provide direct services. So we fund the programs in the community that do. So again, we try to understand what your needs were and then point you towards the programs that we're aware of that might be able to help you, or we'd point you towards 211.
So I'm going to be doing a lot of traveling around the community trying to find someone who can offer me some kind of help.
Well, it depends what kind of help you need. If you need help paying your rent, if you need help finding food, you know, it depends what your need is. Or if you have multiple, if you come in with a list of needs and issues, then you're going to be visiting a lot of different services.
The question is there one place to go that handles all? And the answer is no.
There's not a one place that can take care of all of your needs.
But I will say, if you have a need that an agency actually meets, I mean, an agency can address, it's not like you have to go running all over town. This whole idea that people have this idea that, oh, people don't know where to go. They go. The reason the people are running off, and besides you can do the running on the phone, the reason people are running all over town is because there is no agency that provides what you need. And so they're looking, and sometimes some agencies make bad referrals, and I try real, real hard not to do that. Our office, I don't send people someplace, just, I can't help you, so try this one. Mm-hmm. We do get bad referrals, because there's some people who just give them because they don't want to tell people there's nothing for you.
Right.
So they say, oh, try calling public health. And it's like, so you call public health, and go, oh, why they send it here? I can't help you, and et cetera, et cetera. And that's really what the runaround is. If, like I said, if you called me and said, I'm a senior citizen, and I'm going to have to get out of my place. My lease is up, and the landlord in the spring, my landlord is going to is not going to renew it. I'd say, okay, I'm glad you called now, because the Housing Authority's wait list for senior citizen housing, or which is age 55 or older, is open now. But if you called and you were under age 55 and you want to get, how do I get on a wait list for subsidized housing? My lease is going to be up in a few months. There is no wait list for subsidized housing right now. So you don't have to run all over, but I can tell you, you can come to one place, I can tell you, I'm sorry, there's nothing, which doesn't help you, but you don't have to run all over for it.
It just sounds so desperate.
It
and
is.
I know all three of you are sympathetic to this, but it just makes one feel like, why even bother?
Mm-hmm. Why even bother looking for help?
Why bother looking for help of any kind? You know, I'll just keep working, sleep on someone's doorstep, and
a lot of people feel that way.
I don't know how they cope with that kind of thing, and I get it that the money isn't coming in, but it's just shocking that there's
not something. And I'll tell you, you want to shock more? If you default on your mortgage, you have 6 months to redeem. If you default and not lose your house, if you default on your rent, this is Illinois state law, and it's like this in most states, 5 days. And if you can't come up, if you don't pay and they give you a 5-day notice, you've got 5 days to pay, and after the 5 days, they don't accept anything except they're evicting you. And that's a reality too. I have the pleasure of delivering that news to lots of people who don't want to hear it. And even rent assistance programs, this is a minor point compared to the fact there's no money, but even when there is money, can you get the assistance in time to stop the eviction when you've only got a 5-day window? And the only clients for whom the rent assistance works are the ones whose landlords really want the money more than the eviction and will wait more than the 5 days if Regional Planning Commission really is going to come up with the money. It is, as far as if it sounds horrible, it is more horrible than you're even realizing. Yeah. And this is people's lives. And this is thousands of people.
Well,
on that happy note.
Yeah.
Are there any other questions or comments from the group?
Can I add something to try and wrap it up on a more positive, uplifting note? I'm gonna try. We do have some great resources in this community. So let's take your example for just a second. Your scenario. We have to help. We want to catch people before they get in that spiral. And we do have some great programs available that can do that. So if you're coming looking for help because you're working a minimum wage job and you're struggling to afford your rent and so forth, you know, that's where we do have a lot of organizations that can talk with you about okay, why are you working a minimum wage job? What's your education level? What are your goals for the future? Let's help you look at that. You know, maybe we can focus your income that you do have on your rent and your utilities so you can at least stay housed or, you know, buddy up in an apartment with somebody. You know, I think if you walk in, I think a lot of our social service providers provide way more than what they're supposed to provide.
Which agency would you, would say a person go to with a minimum wage job who wants help with getting more education?
Then that's where you go to the Illinois WorkNet Center. Mm-hmm. You talk to Parkland.
Yeah,
there are, you know, I think those would be great places to start. And those are some of the wonderful resources that we have for individuals to try and improve their circumstances.
Urbana,
Regional Planning Commission,
Urbana
Adult Education.
United Way.
Mm-hmm.
Off Church Street, they walk
we're
in
very
there.
Friendly.
You would be able to
send to those
somebody
places.
A list
we,
a specific mm-hmm. modified to what their request mm-hmm. is so that they can.
Right. We don't advertise that we do that, but when we have individuals that come in, we don't usually just stop them at the door. They're coming to us because they're desperate for some reason or somebody's made a referral to us. So we try and figure out where they've been and not send them on a wild goose chase, but get a little bit better picture of what they're coming from and what they really need, and then try and point them in that right direction. You know, and again, I think a lot of our social service providers do that mm-hmm. because somebody ends up on their door and they don't like to say, sorry, there is no help. Mm-hmm. So it is probably the most creative mm-hmm. Group of individuals you could
yes.
possibly meet. Human service workers, professionals are very creative and can string a lot of things together to try and help people out. So, mm-hmm. you know, some places you might end up and they are going to be a little bit more brisk because it is easy to become jaded seeing the challenges and the frustrations that are out there. But I think in this community, I think you could find help. But we do have resources like Parkland, like the Illinois WorkNet Center, like Urbana Adult Education, that are poised and willing to help people who are ready to look at their future and make some changes to hopefully open up more opportunities for them so it's not a paycheck to paycheck situation. So just trying to put it on a more positive
right.
note before we wrap things up.
Well,
we need more money for everything.
Thank you so much for that effort. let's give our panelists some support. We are going to meet next month in December, and actually I know most of that month is devoted to holidays and winter breaks and such, but we are having a November meeting, or a December meeting, and we will be refocusing our attentions to think about how, again, the lack of a state budget has had an impact on natural resources and environmental issues, because that is mm-hmm. a very big topic here in Illinois as well.
What date is that, Barbara?
The 21st. So we will be here again, and again we will have three wonderful panelists that will sort of walk us through what they're experiencing. I think we're beginning to see some patterns as we move from topic to topic, but I think the more information, direct information we have, the better equipped each of us is to share this with others, to enlighten those who just don't have a clue about where some of these decisions made by legislative bodies is taking us as communities of people. So again, thank you, Esther, Beverly, Kelly, and thank you all, and we'll see you next month.
Thank you.